Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Have a blessed nativity. I am so excited to start to talk about the epistle of St. Paul to Corinthians. First Corinthians, God. I wanted to remind you that the epistles of St. Paul are three categories. Ecclesiastical epistles. Epistles are sent to churches, and they are 10. And the pastoral epistles, 3, 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus. And the personal epistle to Philemon. And each epistle has 6 elements. The name of the sender, the recipients, the blessing, thanksgiving, the theme, the body of the epistle, and the conclusion. And we said that Romans, God is righteousness. But First Corinthians is fellowship, koinonia. We will take introduction about the First Corinthians. It is a practical advice for us all in the church. The church of Corinth had a lot of problems. And we thank God that it happened with them. So in all generations, when these problems happen in any church, they take First Corinthians as a guide. So it is unique. And it is quoted more often and earlier than any other writing of St. Paul because of its importance and usefulness. They found a fragment, they call it moratorium fragment. The moratorium fragment, they found it about 200 years ago. But it returns back to about 170 AD. What is the significance, what is the importance of this fragment? It has the names of the books of the scriptures. And it has First Corinthians, the first of St. Paul's writings, in this fragment. And the epistle with Second Corinthians gives us an early look into the new church, the New Testament church, the structure, the methods, and the message. To understand about the church, we read First Corinthians. I will not take much time in this because we all know First Corinthians is written by St. Paul. He visited Corinth in the second missionary. And St. Paul used to plant a church in the major cities, to found the churches in the major cities. St. Paul met Aquila and Priscilla in Corinth, and St. Paul came alone because both Silas and Timothy were in Macedonia. St. Clement of Rome, later on, he wrote an epistle to Corinthians. And I told you about him. His name is mentioned in the New Testament, in the epistle to Philippians. And also Saint Clement, when he sent his epistle to Corinthians, he tried to solve problems. Even till today, in the church, we find some members are in peace and are peacemakers. And some of them, according to their personalities, and how to deal with them. Even in your service, you will find not all the people with the same personality. The date, it is mid-50s. Mid-50s. When he wrote this epistle. The recipients who received this epistle. We know from archaeology and the scripture that there was a synagogue in Corinth for the Jews. And the church has several groups. They were not in the same level. They had intellectual Greeks, philosophers. And it has Roman patrons, social elite, and a believing Jewish, God-fearing. So they weren't the same level. A large number of converted slaves. Is this, it helps us nowadays? Yes. His Holiness Pope Shenouda once said that when a church asked him to make more than one liturgy for the people who in this place, in this location, and another liturgy for those who are used to help them, to serve them. Of course, His Holiness didn't accept this with liturgy for all people, because we don't have classes in the church, we don't have groups in the church. Always the servants to keep the church in harmony, So they were different groups. Is this a sunset over the Gulf of Corinth? St. Paul heard of the problems. The problems in Corinth are repeated in different ages. How St. Paul heard about these problems from Chloe's people? I think some people, when they read it in 1 Corinthians, they don't understand it. You go like, أخبرت من أهل خلوي. This is their names, the people of Chloe. أهل خلوي. Second, they sent him a letter about certain questions, and these are the references of their letter. Usually St. Paul sends letters to the church, but this church sent letters to St. Paul. Number three, a report from others in the congregation. Number four, a personal visit from Stephanas, Fortunatus, Acacius. In person, they told St. Paul about the problems in this church. It is possible that the letter, number two, was brought by the men number four. Those people, Stephanas, Fortunatus, bring the letter to St. Paul. The theme, what is the theme of 1 Corinthians? Serious problems, disorders in a divided church. In a divided church. The division in the church made them not to focus upon the salvation and our Lord Jesus Christ, but about other issues. Communion with God versus communion with darkness. And how to correct it. We are created for communion with God and with each other. This is important because sometimes we focus upon this part, communion with God. And you hear it sometimes from people, I don't care about the people. I care only about God. It seems good, but it is bad, actually. Because St. John said, if you don't have communion with people, how you will have communion with God? If you can't deal with people, how you will grow in your spiritual life? You know about the monasticism. Does any monastery allow any monk to go in solitude except to live in communion with other monks? Did you hear about it? Someone to go to the monastery, they send him right away to the solitude to live by himself?
The hermit.
They start as hermits or to live in communion with other monks. They live first in communion, because if he doesn't know how to live in communion with his brothers, they don't allow him to go in solitude by himself. So to practice, to start with your brothers and with your sisters. And sometimes when you deal with others, you face difficult situations. Right? But this to teach you, to learn. Let me ask you a question. Is it good to raise your own children to solve their problems and not to allow any problem to face them? What is good for raising children? To make them to face their problems or to solve it for them?
To face.
Because you don't want to raise soft children. They don't know how to face a hard time. A difficult time. So when we deal with each other, we grow spiritually. If I don't deal with my brothers and with my sisters, how I will practice forgiveness? How I will practice patience, endurance? How I will practice I don't have grudge or revenge? Or to do good, or to help, or to support. To repay evil with good. Is this when you deal with others? And also,
we want to practice how we feel that we are members in the same body. We are members in the same body. This is more than we are brothers and sisters, but we are members. We complete each other. We don't live in islands. We don't live separated from each other. So, this is the outline of the chapters. First quarter of this epistle dealing with division in the church. St. John Chrysostom summarized it in one word. He said, this is a scandal. Division in the church, this is a scandal. The second problem is discipline in the church. Did St. Paul act firmly with this sinner, the sinner of Corinth?
Yes.
Was he soft with him?
No.
No? Because nowadays, if you deal firm with someone needs a discipline, you will find many people to say, why wouldn't you do this with him or with her? St. Paul did this with the sinner of Corinth because it needs wisdom. If St. Paul accepted this man to stay in the church and to tell him it is okay, Habibi, it will spread in all generations. It will spread. He will not correct himself. And also, you learn from this also. Why St. Paul disciplined this man publicly? Why he didn't do it secretly, in private?
Because sin was public.
Because sin was public. Because sin was public. He didn't go and told St. Paul about it privately. It was before all the church, before the Holy Church. We found His Holiness Pope Shenouda, may God repose his soul, that he disciplined people publicly in meetings. In meetings. So, division in the church, first four chapters. Chapter 5, discipline in the church. The sinner of Corinth, you know the story of this man? He married his stepmother and still going to the church. So St. Paul punished him. When he repented, St. Paul absolved him and accepted him with love in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Yeah. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. So the discipline, 1 Corinthians 5. The acceptance, 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Number 3, disputes in the courts, lawsuits. They sued each other. In Egypt, we deal with this problem more than here. Because They have a lot of problems regarding inheritances. Houses and farms, and money, and different issues. Disputes in the courts. And the defilement in the world. This, it has a list of immorality. Do you remember when I told you about the homosexuality? In the New Testament, Romans 1, 1 Timothy 1, Judas 1, and 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Because it is in the list. They called homosexuality in this list, and the sodomites. Two names in this list of 1 Corinthians. Chapter 7 is marriage. It has divisions. Marriage and the celibacy. Widows. And he talked about the marriage between the believers and the non-believers. Because both of them, they are converted, and if someone believed, and you remember when I told you about the book of St. John Chrysostom on marriage, he talked about this chapter. If you wanted to talk about the marriage, if you wanted to understand about the marriage, you would read this chapter, 1 Corinthians 7. As you know, Ephesians 5. Chapter 8 to 10, food offered to idols, privileges and responsibility. Food offered to idols. Chapter 11, a church ordinance. In this chapter, he talked about covering the heads of the ladies in the church and the liturgies. He talked about agape meals. And because sometimes they think that agape meals, this is something luxury. No. It is in the beginning of the church. And actually, the scholar Tertullian, he talked about some regulations regarding the agape meal. And St. Paul here, he said that we are not coming to have agape meal just for someone to eat and to be satisfied and someone to live hungry. But he said, we wait for each other. It is agape meal.
Isn't that about the
kasr al-khubz? No, not a kasr al-khubz. Kasr al-khubz in the book of Acts. لكن هنا بيتكلم على مائدة الأغاب. لأن بيقول يهملكمش في البيوت تاكلوا فيها. لما انت تيجي وتعمل كده وتنتظر أخوك. ولا تاكل لوحدك يا ماكل هتاكل لوحدك وتاخد بعضك وتمشي مش كسر خمس خط لا أجابي ميل لأنه يعني we know حتى يعني من our social life يقول لك we eat with each other نحن أكلنا عيش وملح مع بعض يعني for the people also to think that if we eat with each other, it is like a covenant. يعني I can't betray you, I can't talk about you, I can't do something to hurt you. We eat with each other. We eat with each other. And he talked about the Holy Eucharist in this chapter. Actually, he talked about the Holy Eucharist at the end of chapter 10, at the end of chapter 11 also. Chapter 12 to 14, gifts of the Holy Spirit, spiritual gifts. And he said, I will show you an excellent way. And the excellent way, he talked about chapter 13. And as I told you, if you wanted to learn about spiritual gifts, you will read Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians chapter 4. Chapter 15, very important chapter, it is a big chapter, it is the resurrection. He talked about how the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is a cornerstone. Some appearances of our Lord Jesus. Evidences of resurrection. The transition in our resurrected body. And also it has some difficult verses in this chapter, like the baptism of the dead, the submission of our Lord Jesus Christ. When we come, we will discuss a bit more. Chapter 16, the offerings, the almsgiving. And also he said in this chapter that Apollos will come back to you to reveal that he has nothing against Apollos. العلم في الرأس مش في الكراس. First four chapters, divisions. Chapter 5, discipline in the church. Chapter 6, first part, disputes in the courts. Second part, defilement in the world, the immorality. Chapter 7, marriage. 8 to 10, foods offering to idols. 11, church ordinance. Agape covering the heads of the ladies. The Holy Eucharist, 12 to 14, spiritual gifts. And chapter 13 is the excellent way. Chapter 15, resurrection. Chapter 16 is the offerings. St. Paul tried to answer specific problems. So, when any problem like this, it faces us, we return back to the epistle of 1 Corinthians as a guideline for us. Factionalism, divisions, civil lawsuits, sexual immorality, meat sacrificed to idols, Eucharistic theology and the practice, spiritual gifts, resurrection life. Now, he repeated the word now to move from one problem to another. Now concerning the things you wrote about, they sent him letters. Now concerning virgins, now concerning food sacrificed to idols, to the point, now I praise you. Now concerning spiritual gifts, now I make known to you, brothers and sisters, the gospel that I preached to you. Now concerning the collection for the saints, persistent problems in colons. When they start the problem, sometimes they don't solve it right away. It persists, it continues. Saint Clement of Rome, after the martyrdom of Saint Paul with few decades, he said, the more things change, the more they stay the same. الأمور تغيرت ولكن هم إيه ما تغيروش. Around 50 years after St. Paul wrote concerning problems in the church at Corinth. A bishop of the church in Rome wrote to the church in Corinth about further problem. He said, it is a shame for you, poor, beloved. Extremely shameful and unworthy of your training in Christ. That on account of one or two persons, the steadfast and ancient church of the Corinthians is being disloyal to the elders. Because of one or two persons, this is Clement. 10 reasons St. Paul wrote to Corinth. This is according to Ambrosister. What is Ambrosister? Some writings, they are not sure that it is written by Saint Ambrose. So they call it Ambrosister. The first reason, some godly people were disagreeing with one another in partisanship. Wanting to be called the followers of Paul, of Peter, or of Apollos, rather than of Christ. So, the wise members in the church, the wise believers, they don't allow this to happen. St. Paul strongly disapproved of this. Others disagreed with all of the above and declared themselves partisans of Christ alone. Four groups here. This is the first reason. Because this is the most important one. And it took 4 chapters. 1/4 of the epistle. Second reason. The Corinthians were beginning to find pleasure in eloquence and worldly philosophy. Argument, debate. And he told them in chapter 8 that knowledge puffed up. Knowledge puffed up. العلم ينفخ. With the result is that also they were nominally Christian. They were imbued with philosophical notions which were contrary to the faith. Even he talked about the foolishness of God. Why is it empty? The third reason. They were puffed up with anger, frustrated, because Paul had not been to visit them. The fourth reason, concern someone who was guilty of fornication, whom they had allowed to remain in their midst. He talked about the yeast. He talked about the sin as infectious. The fifth was Paul's need to remind the Corinthians of a previous instructions. Sixth reason. The Corinthians were behaving unlawfully and fraudulently toward one another. They took it, the lawsuits. The seventh reason, although Paul was allowed to accept financial support, he refused to do so. He knows when he take and when he reject, when he doesn't accept. So as not to set a precedent for wild or false apostles. Number eight was that they were beginning to be thrown into confusion by heretics on the subject of marriage. Ninth reason was his assertion that everyone should remain steadfast in what he had taught them to believe. The last reason concerned virgins about whom Paul had given no instructions. And there are other reasons as well, which will soon become apparent in the body of the text. This is Emperor Zestar. Corinthian Canal. Briefly, and we will continue to talk about it next time, God will, the division in the church. First four chapters. In chapter 1, he mentioned Sosthenes. Read Daniel, please.
Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother.
Thank you. Joseph?
Then all the Greeks took Sosthenes, the ruler of the synagogue, and beat him before the judgment seat. But Gallio took no notice of these things.
So, from this reference, we know that Sosthenes was ruler of the synagogue. Where is this? This in the book of Acts. 18:17. So to know about Sosthenes, you do cross references. Sosthenes, Reis al-Magma. Saint John Chrysostom, with the letter is addressed not only to those who are already cleansed from their sins, but also to those still looking toward the fuller reception of sanctifying grace. The scholar Origen, its instruction is not limited to the Corinthians, but is applicable to all Christians everywhere. This is interesting. You know, even in the school they do it. Before crossing the wrong answers, you praise the right ones. Praise before criticism. We should to practice this, to do it with our children in service, to mention some good. Saint John Chrysostom says this: whoever starts out with unpleasant words antagonizes his hearers. Advice, counsel, to start with something good. Paul starts by praising them in order to avoid this, because you don't want them to defend themselves. You want them to learn, to be corrected. You see how much the problems, how serious it is, but he started to praise them first. Start with something good. Our Lord did it with the 70 apostles in the Gospel of St. Luke chapter 10. Madame Neville,
I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given to you by Christ Jesus, that you were enriched in everything by him in all eternity and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you.
Thank you. Praising with him.
Ashkar me?
Amunkar. Fadbar.
أشكر إلهي في كل حين من جهتكم على نعمة الله المعطاة لكم في يسوع المسيح. إنكم في كل شيء استغنيتم فيه في كل كلمة وكل علم كما تثبت فيكم شهادة المسيح.
Thank you. Both Arabic and English. Thank you. The scandal of division. The Corinthian church was divided into factions, factionalism, split. They were disagreeing with one another. Some were making Christ the head of affairs. So Paul asked them three questions. This is the last thing we will talk about. He told them, is Christ divided? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? The third one, was Paul crucified for you? Is this to make it shameful? And glory be to God forever and ever. Any question, please?